Yeah, let's start this lecture by talking about common applications of convolutional neural networks. And instead of saying convolutional neural networks all the time, which is pretty hard for me with my German accent, I will just abbreviate them as CNN. So CNN, that's a common abbreviation. Another common one is saying ConvNet. So either one is fine. Both are commonly used in the literature. All right, so what can CNNs do? The simplest application of CNNs would be image classification. So here I have an example of binary classification. It's similar to what we discussed for logistic regression. Except now, of course, we have images as input instead of simpler, let's say, flower classes. So here that's a binary classification problem with cats versus dogs. And yeah, the input image is put into the network. There are convolutional layers. In the end, they are usually fully connected layers. They're not shown here. We will see another type of architecture later that shows the fully connected layer more explicitly. But then it produces a probability score that this image is a cat. And you can also extend that, of course, to multi-class classification using a softmax layer that we also discussed before. So essentially, it's the same thing as we did with multi-layer perceptrons, except that we have convolutional layers, which we will discuss in more detail in this lecture. Another common application of CNNs next to the regular classification is object detection. So here, this is like, you can think of it as a mix between classification and object detection, because usually you predict a bounding box, but you also predict a class label corresponding to the bounding box. So here you have essentially two tasks. So one is essentially identifying objects, for instance here a car, another car, but then also assigning the class label to it. So the network essentially learns how to draw these boxes. So you can think of it as a type of regression task where you can learn these two coordinates here, and these other coordinates, you can derive them from the other two coordinates. So here you're essentially learning the bounding box construction, but then also assigning the label. One common example of that is YOLO, you only look once, but there are of course multiple different methods for that also. So this is like the original YOLO paper. I just referenced it here because it might be the, I would say, easiest starting point if you're interested in that topic. So we won't be talking about this in this class because there are so many other topics to talk about. It is a slightly out of the scope of this class, but if you're interested, this is a good paper to start with. So related to object detection, there is also the task of object segmentation. It's relatively similar, but in addition to identifying, or instead of identifying just a box, so here for reference the boxes are also shown, but the task here is to kind of have an exact mask for that object. So if this is a person, instead of having just the bounding box around the person, you can see it's also extracting this mask here. So it's in that way a little bit more of a precise version of object detection. So here again is a paper, a mask RCN. That's the mask RCNN is like the, I would say, one of the most traditional methods for this. Again, that's a good starting point if you are interested in that topic. There were a few students who were, or could benefit from object segmentation in their class project. And I also shared some tutorials for how to do that in PyTorch with those students. But again, this is, I would say, slightly out of the scope of this class. It's more like an advanced topic. So in this class, we won't be talking about this in too much detail. I just wanted to mention that this also exists. Another task that is something that I have worked on pretty extensively in the past, that's related to face recognition. So face recognition, it's another task. It's somewhat related to classification, but not quite. So here it's really more about pairwise comparisons. I mean, you can phrase image recognition or face recognition as an image classification task. So if the task is to identify a person, you can have it as a classification task where, let's say there are 10,000 potential people and you want to know who that is in that picture compared to a database of 10,000 images. But then it would be an image classification class a task with 10,000 classes, which would be relatively expensive computationally, and also because you don't have many examples per class, it would be really tedious to train such a system. So usually how people approach face recognition is by something called a pairwise or triplet loss. So in that way, what you learn is you learn a certain type of similarity score. So if you have two input images of the same person, it should give you a high similarity. And if the pictures depict different people, it should give you a low similarity score. And then you can set a threshold and say, if the similarity score is above a certain threshold, then it's the same person, otherwise it's a different person. And for that, I mean, there are also many, many different methods. One traditional method would be, for example, using Siamese networks, where you basically have two convolutional networks and they produce embeddings, like feature representations of that image, and then based on the feature representation, you compute a similarity. If they are similar to each other, it could be, for example, low L2 distance or a small cosine angle, then these are the same person, and otherwise they are different people. But yeah, again, this is another topic that might be out of the scope of this class. So in this class, we will be mainly focusing on convolutional networks for classification. Except there's one more topic we will use later on in this class with convolutional networks, and that is generative adversarial networks. So we can also use convolutional networks for image synthesis in the context of a so-called generative adversarial network. And generative adversarial networks are essentially networks that can generate data. So I will explain that in more detail in a dedicated lecture dedicated to generative adversarial networks. But here is just a big picture outline. So here how that works is you have a generator and a discriminator. And the generator takes in some noise. So usually you sample from a random distribution, from a normal distribution, a random vector. And then you put it through a convolutional network that constructs an image from this noise vector. So in that sense, it's more like an inverted convolutional network. So it will output a generated image. And then the discriminator has to say whether this image is real or generated. So you train the generator so that it fools the discriminator into thinking that this generated image actually comes from the training set. And then the discriminator tries to distinguish between generated and real images better. So you train the discriminator to become better at distinguishing those, and you train the generator to become better at fooling the discriminator. And you do that, it's basically like a game, a min-max game, and you do that until the generator is able to produce realistic looking images. But these are images that are, for instance, not contained in the training set. They are more like interpolated, or they are synthesized, so they might look similar to the training set images, but they are usually images that are not one of the training set images. So why is that useful? You can do a lot of fun things with that. And also, I've, for example, seen recently people started using that to make synthetic training examples. So for example, produce larger training sets, but you can also do that for image manipulation. We also used that for a project called PrivacyNet, where we were removing private information from images, or images that for face images, where people, for instance, could use that information for profiling, and we used GANs to kind of alter the images such that they still look like images of real people, but where the sensitive information is hidden. And there are lots of applications of GANs, and that is also some topic that we will discuss in more detail later. So this video hopefully gave you a big picture overview of all the different things you can do with CNNs. So in this lecture, we are now focusing specifically on image classification, because this is still an introductory lecture, so we can't do everything at once. Let's start with the simplest task.